program. Send your listings 3 weeks in advance to KPFA Box 51, 1929 Martin Luther King Jr. Way in Berkeley, California, 94704. Fax them to 510-848-3812 or email us at calendar@kpfa.org. Attention to the community calendar. Tell us if your event is wheelchair accessible. To hear this calendar again, call 510-848-6767, extension 621. The calendar is also online at kpfa.org.
You're listening to KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, or KFCF in Fresno. Or on the web, you can listen at kpfa.org. It's 7 p.m. Up next, Full Circle. Stay with us.
You're traveling through another dimension.
An area not only of sound and ideas, but light.
You're taking a journey to a land without boundaries, where diversity rules.
A dimension that is both multicultural and intergenerational.
You are moving into a field of empowerment and expression.
You are crossing into Full Circle.
Welcome to Full Circle, your cultural and public affairs radio magazine. Last week, our focus was more on cultura, culture, the bedrock for our lives.
Tonight, we come full circle. In the later half of our show, we'll be hosting a panel of speakers to deal with the more serious topic, the death penalty. With Stanley Tukey Williams ready to be executed only 4 days from now, it's important we arm ourselves with information.
Along the way, we'll add sprinkles of segments that deal with youth incarceration.
And some words of wisdom from death row inmate Stanley Tukey Williams himself.
We're your co-hosts, Jorge Roman and Trin Le. Stay tuned, everyone. We're up for some lively discussion.
Approximately 200 youth leaders, young activists, and elder civil rights veterans attended the Gathering of Elders in Alabama early this November. The meeting was called by musician, actor, and human rights activist Harry Belafonte to develop a plan of action to combat juvenile injustice and the incarceration of children as young as 5 years old. Here is Idris Hassan with more.
I was one of several young leaders from across the country invited to attend the second Gathering of Elders held in Epps, Alabama on November 3rd, 4th, and 5th. This meeting was a call by artist and humanitarian Harry Belafonte to bring together elder civil rights veterans with younger generations to form a movement to combat the growing incarceration of young children. Mr. Belafonte's distinguished career as a renowned performer has never eclipsed his passion for justice and human rights. The intense 78-year-old slowly paces the center of our group, holding an enlarged image of 5-year-old Jaisha Scott, who was arrested at Fairmont Park Elementary School in St. Petersburg, Florida. The kindergartner lapsed into a temper tantrum after her teacher, as punishment for too much silliness, took away the jelly beans the class had been using for a math exercise. Jaisha was calming from her episode in the principal's office when 3 officers entered, bent her over, and shackled her tiny wrists and legs.
That's our child. Those are white officers. One woman, one man. They are dressed in police uniforms. And that child is in terror. And she's not the only one. Injustice is everybody's business. And we have got to attack the system that put us here. There is a law that put that child in chains and did it with the sanction of authority. What defied me wasn't in that picture. I've seen children suffering all over this world. What I saw there was a call that said this must stop.
In the name of zero tolerance, teachers and administrative officials are calling on police officers more regularly to arrest behaviorally challenged children. More than 4,500 kids, 11 and under, were charged with crimes in Florida alone through June of 2005. Children as young as 7 years old are incurring felony charges and spending nights in detention centers. These children, often suffering from mental and emotional disorders, are being cast as America's new criminals. Carol Zippert is one of the founders of the Federation of Southern Cooperatives Land Assistance Fund. For over 30 years, the Federation has developed cooperatives throughout the South and have worked to preserve the land holdings of Black family farmers. She was one of the elders that came prepared to share mobilization strategies and to listen to the thoughts of the young people.
You know, I came to hear you, to hear the young folks, because it is your turn.
Motivational speaker Omar Neal, moderator for the gathering, rallies the group as the elders are recognized.
All of the elders, let's stand and let's give them a round of applause. If you're an elder, stand. All of the people who are part of the movement, the elders, please stand. Now let's give them a round of applause, like we appreciate them.
I was honored to be in the presence of elders such as nonviolent and civil rights activist Diane Nash, former Black Panther and educator Kathleen Cleaver, and Daniel Nane Alejandres, founder of the Santa Cruz-based National Coalition of Barrios Unidos. Barrios Unidos has been acknowledged as one of the nation's most impressive grassroots organizations addressing issues of youth violence and gangs. Nane shares his story of transformation from a young child witnessing domestic violence to an anger-filled youth inflicting violence on others to a peace warrior promoting nonviolence nationally and internationally.
And at the age of 13, I stabbed another person, a young man that looked like me. At the age of 17, I shot another kid. I didn't want to do these things, but I didn't know how to get out of the cycle. My dad always said, don't cry, be a man, don't cry. But I really had a lot of tears in me. I had a river of tears that I really wanted to shed. But I held them inside and I would take it out of somebody else. We as men, we got to go back there to that pain that's right here. And when we go in there, we want to cry, but we still hold it back. But today I don't have to hold it back. Today I can shed my tears, I don't care. Because I can shed my tears because today I work with men. I work with men in the prisons. They're not afraid to shed tears. Yes, sir. And sometimes those men that are afraid, they can't wait to get into the shower to shed them tears.
Not only were there powerful testimonies such as Nane's, but poetry as well. Muhib Dyer and Ketwana Dixon are poets and educators working with the Campaign Against Violence in Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Y'all ready for some poetry? Say yeah.
Yeah.
Y'all believe in life? Say yeah.
Yeah.
You tired of police brutality? Say yeah.
Yeah.
You tired of incarceration of youth? Say yeah.
Yeah.
You tired of young Black and brown boys being locked up? Say yeah.
Yeah.
Give yourselves a big round of applause. Ain't no more poems to
come
write.
Come on now.
You see that no more songs
no
to sing.
More
that
songs.
No more poems
no
to write.
More poems.
You see that too many Black and brown faces behind the wall.
Come on.
Ears can't hear the
alley income call for freedom. Come on now.
Rich, herded like cattle dumped into the belly of the beast.
Come on.
I'm in the courtroom screaming, no justice,
no peace.
Come on. Executed 73 men and women in Texas.
They locked us up, but they stole an election.
Muhib pays tribute and respect to the elders.
It's really a humbling experience to be in the presence of men and women who really, really did it. It makes me, to a certain extent, feel like I haven't done enough. You know what I mean? Like nothing I can do can be comparable to men and women who sacrificed their lives, men and women who have been to jail many times to give me the rights and the freedoms that I have right now. It just makes me want to learn more, kind of want to sit at their feet and educate myself so that hopefully one day I could be like them.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but
Following 3 days of discussions and deliberation among the group, Malika Sanders, president of the 21st Century Youth Leadership Movement in Selma, Alabama, presents an action plan.
Why are we allowing the mass imprisonment of our children and youth and the unjust enrichment of private corporations off of their pain and misery under the pretense of justice? And so the purpose for this proposal is to develop a stronger local, regional, and national context to free our communities through proposal and initial campaign to end the incarceration of our children and youth.
At the conclusion of the event, I spoke with Nane about the growing fight to save Stanley Tukey Williams from his upcoming execution. Williams, one of the co-founders of the Los Angeles street gang, the Crips, was arrested and sentenced to death for crimes that he says he is innocent of. Since his imprisonment, he has redeemed himself as an author and peace advocate and has also touched the lives of countless youth.
I definitely have been talking and praying about Tukey and what is his upcoming date on execution. We were talking against the death penalty, and especially a person that has been able to turn his life around and help to stop the violence in our communities. You know, we don't want the execution of Tukey Williams, but we also, it tells the community that we must mobilize, because these are our relatives that are being executed. These are our relatives that from the get-go, from a young age, are being railroaded into the juvenile justice system. And if we don't change the juvenile justice system as it is now, there will be many Tukeys waiting in death row.
Nane and Mr. Belafonte, who have worked closely on this project, share their thoughts on the outcome of the gathering.
This gathering here of bringing youth and elders, I think is an amazing thing to happen across this country, so that the young people that are locked up can hear and see that the elders are coming back for them. We're not going to let them rot away in those jail cells.
I am very rewarded by the kind of response, the kind of energy, the kind of spirituality, the kind of intellectual, the kind of emotional display that has taken place over the last 3 days here. I think the community of elders and the onslaught of the young had a perfect union. And I think everyone has understood that we need to reevaluate and reassess where we are and where we have to go. The outcome of all this has yet to be defined. If history repeats itself, then we could have another SNCC. If history repeats itself, then we could have another youth movement that's filled with purpose and desire and intelligence.
For Belafonte, this was a significant first step in bridging generational gaps and offering a contribution to a growing youth movement.
Each century brings different conditions. Each generation is exposed to different nuances. I expect that all these seeds that are being planted will give us a harvest of new thinking, new power, new realities, and a more universal order of joy in which we all live.
The weekend of December 16th, Barrios Unidos will host a follow-up meeting to outline action steps and to plan for the next gathering of elders, which will take place at the Onondaga Indian Reservation in upstate New York. For more information, visit www.barriosunidos.net. Reporting from Alabama, I'm Idris Hassan for Full Circle.
Many thanks, Idris, for that feature on the gathering of elders. Our elders' grasp of history can really give insight on where we've been, where we are, and help us as the next generation of leaders figure out how to move forward. Next up, we got a music break for y'all. The song is Free, a collaboration by Frontline, The Soul Snatchers, Rico Pavón, and Cam, off of the new collaborative album, Redemption, Hip Hop United to Save Stan Tukey Williams. Check it out, y'all.
I want to say of the brother that he touched me deeply. I never met him before. I didn't know of his past life. But I learned of him that the man that I met at San Quentin is as far removed from the man that was Stan Tookie Williams, co-founder of the Crips, as the far planet Pluto, which is 4,600,000,000 miles from the Earth. That is as far away from what he was as what he is.
Yes, check it. Yo, blue rage, black man in a cage in San Quentin. Animal in the jungle language used against the brown man, against the black man. We got your backstand. React to the fact it's a Supreme Court. Let it stand. Raise up the appellate hand. Yell it if you smell it, man. Tookie ain't no rookie. The cookie jaws gotta raise his hand. First we gotta save your life, then we gotta get you out. If we gotta wait you out, we may have to break you out.
Black and born, captive in the USA. Raised in the wicked game people play. Struggle and pain is part of the insane waves of the ghetto, U.S. death row. But where the spirit flow, only the Lord knows. So we rhyming for freedom and justice to get the peacemaker off death row. It's a growing generation who need him to keep writing Tookie books because they need
an
him.
An animal in his habitat rage, the lion cage, the court sway. The D.A. use metaphors this way. Soul snatchers be the prophets of rage. We on the front line and on the front page with who says,
I don't think so.
So as the people go about blind in their everyday lives, set up by those everyday lies, hope that they can drop a lie in a line as we remorse through the course of time and intercourse with the source of life.
Policy is hypocrisy. How can a person believe in a system, believe in the midst of the angst, making their decisions from high ranks, jeopardizing a life where anybody can buy faith?
The death date is set as December the 13th. The mission is to execute the protocol for peace. The mission is to extinguish any brother helping deflect the violence in the system so the victims took you will.
Yo, so we can paint the picture to change and remake the scripture so people that ain't conflicted could listen and pay attention. But it's deeper than us, it's deeper than waving shots, it's deeper than Jamie Foxx. We stuck in the same spot.
The number's 916-445-2841. Do me a favor, call Governor Schwarzenegger and let him know this rose in the concrete deserves to grow.
No. Way too many people in power positions living with hate in their minds. Some of them even think that they have the right to be faking the role of the Most High. When it comes to taking a black man's life, I wonder if they think twice. Would they rather us die than leave us alive in a 4x9-foot cell for life? How do they justify a homicide as a punishment for homicide? Retaliation's just an eye for an eye, right? So who are the thugs now that the power's changed hands? And the official who doesn't stand against them killing of this man?
From the hoes of y'all ships, the crack of y'all whips, unloading of y'all clips, Vietnam and Iraq trips, blacks been dying from the lying out of y'all lips. Right. So calling on all blood and all Crips. Soon revolution gon' pop. It's gon' get this Ku Klux Klan, black man murder don't stop. Off top, we gon' ride by the millions. By the millions. Now every ex-slave say Stan Tookie Williams.
Welcome back to Full Circle. Just a quick announcement before we continue. KPFA's 35th annual Crafts Fair is happening this weekend, Saturday and Sunday from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. There'll be tons of artists, music, and food, and there is a free shuttle from the Civic Center BART. We have one pair of tickets to give away for this Crafts Fair, so give us a call at 510-848-4425 and be caller number 10. That's 848-4425. Give us a call.
Moving the show right along. Now that we've heard a song for Tookie, it's only fit that we hear from Tookie himself. we dug into our Full Circle archives to share an interview by a former Full Circle apprentice, Dana Granby, who interviewed Mr. Stan Tookie Williams about 3 years ago. The beeps you'll hear is courtesy of the California Department of Correction and Rehabilitation, who record all phone calls. Yep. Nonetheless, Mr. Williams' insight proves timeless. Appreciate the wisdom, y'all.
Thanks for tuning in to Full Circle this evening. My name is Dana, and on the line I have Stanley Tookie Williams. Mr. Williams, thanks for joining me.
You're welcome. I'm honored, really.
Do you think that in order for us to obtain peace, we have to first see war?
No. No, that's absurd. I've heard that theory before. I find it, that's quite insane to me. I mean, to believe that murder is the solution for our problems or war is the solution for our problems, that's insane. You can't establish peace and think that it can be maintained by means of aggression. Peace can't be extorted, intellectualized, or peddled like a commodity. That's an illusion.
What, in your vision, what is peace?
That's a pretty good question. I mean, well, let's just say peace is a bold concept. It's a subjective concept that I consider to be based on MOT, that's M-A-A-T. It's a comedic term for truth, justice, and righteousness. And believe me, it's not for the faint of heart, the warmonger, nor the charlatan. I mean, the fact of the matter is, peace has to be developed within. History has shown us that without inner peace, people will tend to violate the truth, break promises, or extend an olive branch with one hand while holding a weapon in the other.
How do you go from taking that internal peace that cultivates within you and applying it to your world?
It becomes a natural process. I've always told individuals that peace in itself is like a link to God, in a sense. It's a connection. You know, you have that aura about you that no one can take away. So you become, in a sense, fearless. It's all about how I project myself through peace. And the beautiful part about it is anybody can embrace it.
In your books, how do you offer children visions of peace?
The books in itself is, I consider it to be more of a caveat, something to warn children about, because I've experienced this madness and I know what they're heading for if they end up traveling down the path that I have. Throughout those books, I warn them about gangs, I warn them about drugs, weapons, and things of that nature. And my main objective is for them to obtain an education. Because once they start going to a juvenile hall, they'll end up being in CYA, then prison, then before they know it, they'll end up on death row, like a lot of these youngsters are. So it's more of a warning that this isn't the type of life they want to experience. Actually, it is no life, being in prison.
How do you find peace in the state penitentiary? How do you find peace where you're at today?
Well, it's not something that is external. I have to find it. It's within. I establish my own peace through prayers and reading, writing children's books. I find it when I exercise. I find peace when I receive a visit. When I'm talking to people that I love over the phone, things of that nature. It's something that has to come from within. And the fact of the matter is unless, you know, a person can develop peace within, believe me, you can't experience it with anyone else.
How do you think the government or, say, like state or local laws contribute to the lack of peace in urban settings?
There's nothing out there that, in a sense, exemplifies hope. I mean, where there is hopelessness, there will be chaos and murder and other forms of pandemonium. So it's a lack of many things out there. Lack of adequate schools, things of that nature. So there are many contributing factors that helps to perpetuate the madness out there in Oakland, Richmond, Fremont, L.A., and all these other urban areas.
So how would you suggest that the members of these communities go about changing this?
That one thing for sure is they can't necessarily wait on the government to conduce them to address these social ills. They have to get together and they have to establish a social agenda, you know, a blueprint of some kind to address the poor, you know, the literate, the, you know, drug addicts and homeless and other people, especially the unemployed and other deprived people. Without a social agenda, you're just winging. You're improvising. A social agenda is very important. And you'd be surprised what a collective amount of poor people can do together. Fighting is one.
What causes you the most concern with regard to the future of the youth in the inner city?
Not being properly or correctly educated. And I say that because the majority of individuals that I've ran into, and myself included one time, we didn't know a thing about our culture. We ended up adopting other people's methods and cultures and things of that nature and their mores. But when it came to our own, we were somewhat bankrupt.
What advice would you offer young people?
Well, depending upon where they are, an education is of the most importance. I keep stressing that because without an education, you can't, put it this way, I've always told individuals that through an education it leads to, in a sense, a form of being able to reason, a rationale. And through this reasoning and this rationale, a youth can develop a conscience. And through a conscience comes the form of redemption, being able to reach out to other people and helping those who are less fortunate.
Are you ever disillusioned by what the future may hold for today's youth?
Oh, no. No, no. I'm not a pessimist, nor am I a defeatist. I believe that, what's that term? Dumb Spiro Sparrow. I breathe, I hope. So that I always have. And I foresee things getting better. It just takes time. And I believe also that the younger generation are going to grow up and teach us adults what we should have been doing. We'll be able to learn from them how it's, you know, how peace can be achieved. He's getting ready to get the phone.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Mr. Williams. We wish you the best.
Your call is terminated.
Wow, yo. That's really symbolic. His call was terminated. Many thanks to Dana for that interview done in 2002. This is Full Circle on KPFA 94.1 FM. We're your co-hosts, Jorge Roman and Jen Le. Up next, we have the pleasure to host a guest panel of speakers. The topic, the death penalty.
With Stanley Tukey Williams' upcoming execution set for next Tuesday, December 13th at 12:01 a.m., Mr. Williams has been a hot topic of discussion. But let's move on now to our panelists and have them help us make sense of the current situation and see what we can do as a community about the death penalty and Tukey's case.
In our studio, we have Mr. Fred Jackson from the Save Tukey Committee and Gina Spitz from the Campaign to End the Death Penalty. Welcome, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank
Good
you
to
for
be
having
here.
Us.
No problem. Our pleasure is ours.
Okay.
The first question is for Mr. Jackson. How do you think that Schwarzenegger, given his recent falling out with the California electorate, you know, all the initiatives he was backing really fell through, how do you think that now he will, this result will affect his decision on Tukey's case?
You know, I have given that some thought, but basically what I feel is that somewhere there is compassion, and I think the fact of Tukey's case and where it is today, and I think that, you know, we get in politics, things can fall either way, but I feel that there's something that transcends politics, mm-hmm. It transcends the now, and it reaches to that metaphysical part of us, and I believe that somewhere in the governor's heart that he will find the compassion to do the right thing. I really believe that. Now, if it doesn't happen, I'll be disappointed. But at this point, I believe it. And I think it will transcend politics. Now, he full well know that his standings is down. He's pretty flat right now.
Right.
And and it would seem that it would be in his benefit to be more reaching out towards all humanity that he could do this deed, and it would show that the Terminator is not a computer-generated person, but rather a real compassionate individual. And I think somewhere in him that it will come forward.
So you really feel that right now there's a good position where there's political expedience. It's a good decision for him to give clemency, given the political climate. Yet at the same time, you do feel that he will show compassion.
Right. I feel that he'll show compassion. And I think it would be, in my view, and I think it would like transcend the expediency, you know, of his political situation. But I think it's there, and I believe it.
But what if that strategy, what if he doesn't grant clemency? Well, what's the next move? What's the next step?
Okay, if he doesn't grant clemency, it's close to being all over. Being not a legal scholar when it comes to attorneys and their forte, I would still, whatever I can do as a person who's supporting him, surely my job is not over. No matter what happened, I'll continue. Even if he should, you know, be executed, I'll still continue his work.
Okay.
So, Gina, do you have any thoughts on the possibilities of what Governor Schwarzenegger might decide?
Again, going back to the political expediency issue, I think that considering that his polling numbers are currently so low, it would be risky for him to appear so tough on crime on such a controversial case, in which, I mean, Stan T. Williams has garnered such a following from the good work that he's done. And so I think that it would be a big political risk for Schwarzenegger to not grant him clemency. Now, I definitely think that it's still possible that he could refuse to give him clemency, but I'm hoping that the political climate will actually sway it in our way.
Stanley Tukey Williams did an interview with Amy Goodman a few days ago, and he talked about how officials from the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation had been publicly advocating to have him executed, which is something they're not supposed to do. They're supposed to be impartial.
Right.
Do you have any sense of how this could affect his appeal for clemency, either of you, like either positively or negatively?
I think the fact that this hurry up, this all-out effort to, you know, get Stanley Tukey Williams, let's get him off the scene, it appears that there is something that somebody don't want to be brought out. Mm-hmm. Other words, there is a fear that if his life is extended, then that's really opens up Pandora's box. That is just the tip of the iceberg of the shortcomings of the criminal justice system. So I think that there is that point there in mind of people. And if someone sees on that, as we are doing right now, and I'm doing it right now, is that there is something sinister at the way that there's a move to really get him off the scene. By the mere fact that his death date was set for December the 13th, and from my understanding, I think it's the first time in history that someone has been killed, so at least set to be executed so close to Christmas.
That's crazy.
Yeah, just if I could say something. I agree with Fred, but I also think that it's important to account for everybody who's come out for his case as well. I mean, for his clemency, such as, you know, Snoop Dogg and the high-profile celebrities and, you know, a high following of just, you know, normal people that in whose lives he's actually changed. So I think that that's a powerful force in contrast to these prison officials that are coming out.
You just heard the voice of Gina Spitz. You're listening to Full Circle on 94.1. Gina Spitz is with the campaign to end the death penalty. We also have Fred Jackson with the Save Tukey Committee. And tonight we're talking about the death penalty.
Oh, well, if I may have the next question. This one is for Ms. Spitz. I was wondering, the death penalty, the claims against it is that it does not deter crime.
Mm-hmm.
and that there's a very real possibility that the people that they may be executing are innocent.
That is true.
However, how about in instances where there isn't any evidence of prosecutorial wrongdoing, such as in Tukey's case, and the accused is convicted, wouldn't that be a good case where the death penalty should stand?
I think that in talking about the death penalty overall, we can't isolate it ever to just one case that would possibly be okay to execute someone. There's always going to be a possibility for error, a possibility for executing innocent people. Since the reinstation of the death penalty in 1976, over 120 people have been exonerated from death row, I think showing the flaws that are built into the death penalty that cannot be erased by any sort of, you know, restructuring or anything like that.
Yeah, but along the same vein, I think that people also say that the death penalty is discriminatory against poor people and people of color. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering, how is it that you think that it's racist?
Well, for instance, the probability of a black person, for instance, getting the death penalty is much higher if you compare a black person that is a similar case to a white person for getting the death penalty. And also it heavily relies on the color of the victims as well. I mean, even though most capital crimes involve minority or black-on-black crime, the people on death row are there for black-on-white crime. So that's something that you also have to look at. And I think that Stan's case is very exemplary of how racism works in the system, because, you know, his case was moved from South Central to Torrance. Blacks were excluded from his jury. He was compared to a Bengal tiger in his trial. I mean, the list goes on, and this is not unique to his case. It occurs in all death penalty cases across the nation.
Thanks.
So this next question is for either one of you. What do you think the social climate around the death penalty is right now? I mean, we know that in Illinois there's been a moratorium, but what do you think specifically people are feeling about the death penalty within California, and how is that affecting your organizing?
Well, I would like to say that I think that let's say that the death penalty in these days is causing people to steal and listen. Now, there's a lot of dynamics out there that's happening and has happened. One being is that there are many people that's being exonerated from their crimes using DNA.
Yeah.
So we have a better way of determining who is really guilty, who is innocent. And also, beyond that, is that we have people who have been executed. Now, just understand that just 2 months ago, a person was executed in Texas, and he's found out to be innocent. And that's been on my mind ever since I found out. And so I found that out from Gina tonight, thank God.
Actually, just to correct that, I was a 10-year case. He was executed about 10 years ago, and then it came out like 2 weeks ago that he was innocent after his execution.
In which that's his fault. To Stan's case, that's different things are coming out now that happened 20 years ago concerning his case, and which is leading to the points that she brought out. There were footprints that the assailant left at the scene of the crime that didn't fit Stan, and they didn't find out who the footprint belonged to. There was fingerprints at the crime scene of one of the crimes, and they didn't fit Stan. They didn't find out who it was. There was a note at one crime scene. It wasn't Stan's handwriting, so they just kind of said, in the strict sense of the word, is that we have a man here that we want off the streets. And so, and to answer your question, and I think these things, Stan have said right from the beginning that he was innocent, and people thought he was just, you know, he have this brute, you know, they called him the brute, you know, the bingo tiger, you know, as he'd been alluded to by an assistant DA. They said, oh, everybody says they're innocent. But now this information began to crop up, and people are listening. People are listening. Now they are taking, having second thoughts. Even in the community of Richmond, where I have my kids, the Internet Project for Street Peace, people now coming to me, oh, I didn't know that happened. Mm-hmm. And I was telling them that the kids, which I teach about Stan's book, we work with his case, they knew it all along. And so there is, I think the wind is blowing. There's a change in out there about the death penalty. Now, some people is going to let you down easy, and some is just going to say it straight out. But I believe that the wind is blowing where the death penalty will come a thing of the past until they can be sure that it's airtight and that you are really executing the right person.
Now, would you restrict that to California, or do you really think the winds are blowing across the entire nation?
I believe it's blowing across the entire nation. And remember that the world is getting smaller. And when I say that, we have a worldwide neighborhood. Going to France is just like going next door. And so that was a time that what happened in America, it was relegated to America. But now the world as a whole, you know, it has this distaste, for the most part, for capital punishment, and America will have to follow sooner or later. You can put your foot on it.
So I guess a question following that up would be, if we get rid of the death penalty, we still have a prison system in place, a prison system that is massively flawed. And how do you feel like your work in organizing against the death penalty also extends into organizing against the prison system as a whole?
For my organization, and how we tackle the issue of the death penalty relates to how injustices work in the criminal justice system in general, such as tackling it on the issue of racism, on the issue of inadequate representation for the poor. For instance, with Stan's case, His case flies in the face of the idea that people in prison and people on death row are not capable of making a positive contribution to society. And so I think that coming from that standpoint, we could definitely use these same organizations to fight against those injustices in the prison system. And I think Fred's organization is a good example of how we can focus on the issue of, we're building more prisons than we're building schools, for instance. Mm-hmm. So if you wanted to talk about that.
Yes, I would just like to add that that is what I call a front-end education and a back-end education. The front-end education is the public school system, mm-hmm. and the back-end education is the criminal justice system. So Stan, unfortunately, but yet through his redemption, he have shown that the back-end education can excel. In fact, the governor should be proud that his criminal justice system has produced a man like Stan who have really pulled himself up by, I can't say his bootstrap, let's say right. Pulled himself up by his handcuffs. Okay. Maybe I can say, and have done so well. So he can inspire, and he can inspire others who are on the front end, and we have this deficit on the front end education. We have a lack of funding, lack of after-school programs, overcrowded classroom, lack of sufficient teachers, and I could enumerate on and on. But Stan have kind of eliminated the excuse and said that you can overcome. And this is now, the onus is on the school system to straighten up and fly right and make sure that our kids get educated, because if 40% are dropping out, then a certain percent of those are heading from school, the public school, to the prison school.
Great. I'd like to welcome everybody. This is Full Circle. Today we have Mr. Fred Jackson from the Save Tukey Committee and Gina Spitz from the Campaign to End the Death Penalty. We're just talking with them in regards to Mr. Stanley Tukey Williams' situation. And one thing I would like to do, I'd like to open up the phones. Well, at least have people call now. So those folks who like to have questions given to our guests, just feel free to call 510-848-4425. That's 510-848-4425. And, you know, just get on the roll call and we'll get to you. Back to our discussion. One question that really has been on the back of my mind is an article I read today on the Oakland Tribune. Mm-hmm. It cited district attorney from Los Angeles. I believe his name is John Monaghan. Mm-hmm. And what he said was given the fact that a lot of the reasons for giving clemency to Tukey is that he's done such a good work and he can actually make peace accords on the streets, it gives a sense that he has street legitimacy. I'm wondering if that's really true, because Mr. Monaghan, he mentions how a peace treaty he made in New York, New Jersey, actually has fallen through. So I guess it would that really be a good angle to appeal to the public, I mean, in terms of like him being able to broker street deals?
What he says, I'm not sure whether that occurred, but just for a chance, if it did, of course, that he established the peace, mm-hmm. a starting point, even if it only lasted for a week. You know, that means that, you know, his peace protocol works. Now, the last I've heard, it was holding. So mm-hmm. I can't say that the district attorney, what he is, the assistant district attorney, what he says is in fact true. Because in this political climate, there's very little you can believe, unfortunately, from the criminal justice system, especially in L.A. There are so many inconsistencies, and there are so many things that have been darkened by their...
So it's just rumors.
Right. So you see, they can start a rumor and say anything. So I would say, I don't know that, but what Fred Jackson can say, I run the Internet Project for Street Peace in North Richmond, California, and I can say that those kids that I deal with will tell the news media and has told news media all around the world, says, if I had ever thought about joining a gang, by reading Tukey's books, it have let me know not to do it. There are kids who would say, I want to be a writer because Stanley Tukey Williams showed what he could do from death row. They know that he sleeps on his floor of his cell, and that he uses his bed for a writing table. And they said, I want to get my homework. I want to be good like Stan.
We have a caller on the line. This is Gloria from San Rafael. Can we hear your question? Hello, is Gloria on the
line? Right here.
Hi, what's your question?
My question is, and I want to preface my question by saying that it is obviously my hope, and along with other people, that this man will be given clemency. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a tragedy that the political climate is driving how this will come out, it seems like, rather than looking at all the good works he's done. Mm-hmm. But after having said that, does the group that's there tonight have faith, have hope, have a belief that he will receive clemency as he so deserves?
Yes, I believe he will. Yeah, this is Fred, and I believe he will.
I think that it's possible. I'm not sure if it's going to happen. I certainly hope so. Again, as I said before, I think that it would be a political mistake for him not to. Obviously, I want him to get clemency. So,
great. Thank you for your answers. Next up, we have Giovanni. Is it Giovanni?
Yes.
From Marin?
Yes.
How you doing, Giovanni?
Good.
Good, good. What's your question?
Well, I had just a comment. I think, you know, Tukey Williams is such a positive person.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, mm-hmm. and he just radiates that in every aspect of his life. And that earlier today, one of the victims, a relative of one of the victims, spoke up and said that he felt a peace that of this whole thing, and that he would go against putting Mr. Williams to death. And so I thought, I think we just have to think really positively that this is all going to work out.
Great. Thank you for that comment.
I agree, Colin. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Do we have any other questions, or should we? We can move along. A question that... Actually, I'm going to give the number again in case there are any folks out there who still have questions they want to ask. The number is 510-848-4425, and you're listening to Full Circle on 94.1. We're talking about the death penalty tonight with Gina Spitz from Campaign to End the Death Penalty and Fred Jackson from Save Tukey Committee. So a question which actually came up in a meeting that we had a couple days ago was the way that some people find it problematic when prisoners are like Mumia or Stanley Tukey Williams get highlighted, and other prisoners don't receive the same amount of support or attention. And there's this sense that their cause is really a celebrity cause, and it doesn't really advance the anti-death penalty movement. What would you say to people who have that criticism?
I would say that, you know, we use these cases in order to highlight the flaws that are endemic in the death penalty as a whole. For instance, we use Stan's case to show how racism works, racism, classism works within the death penalty as a whole. And I think that continuing to fight against the death penalty by highlighting these instances of injustice is a very effective tool in being able to eventually abolish the death penalty in California.
So do you really think that let's say Stanley Tukey Williams gets executed, you know, there's nothing we can really do about it. Mm-hmm. It happens. Do you really think that actually will invigorate people into supporting the anti-death penalty cause any even more? Will he be a martyr, or will it actually diffuse the situation where it'll just bring people back down to zero and it's the next 5 years until something like this really happens again?
Yeah, I see what you're saying. I think that there's so much support, especially around Stanley Tukey Williams' case, against his execution, that there's no way that Schwarzenegger could, you know, let the execution happen without there being outrage. And I mean, I think that since his case, I mean, really, like, even in the media has highlighted all these things that are wrong with the death penalty, and the fact that he's, you know, contributed so much to society, and that there, you know, that there's obviously then the possibility that there's other innocent people on death row, other people that are on death row because of racism in their case, other people that are on death row that are capable of these kinds of contributions. I think that that's going to, you know, have a resonance in society.
Thank you, Gina. I don't know. We're actually kind of short on time, okay. So I wish we could hear what Fred had to say, but I think we're going to have to move along.
Okay. Yeah, we just have one more question from a caller.
Okay.
It's Willie from Oakland. Willie, are you there? Willie. Well, I guess we lost him. Oh, no, there you are. How you doing, Willie?
Okay, yeah, I'm fine. How
good. You doing? I'm doing pretty good myself. Well, what's your question, sir?
Yes, to your guests, do anyone ever consider that when there is a truce between the gangs, that, you know, the police themselves, or they hire somebody to disrupt this by going and killing someone or doing something to a member of the opposing gang, and, you know, that breaks the truce, because they don't want a peace. They don't want peace between the gangs, because it's just like how we operate all over the world. Anything we want, then we send someone in there to, you know, and start the violence and put who we want in power. Do you ever consider that fact?
Do you want to take that question, Fred?
Absolutely. It doesn't take a rocket scientist or a Rhodes Scholar to understand that the Black Panthers had to go, says J. Edgar Hoover. Then, you know, then FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover. And Stan's case, it wasn't so much that he was accused or found guilty of killing four people that they wanted him off the street. But they wanted Stan off the streets because he could organize young Afro-Americans. And so they had to throw something in the pot.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, you're absolutely right. We know now, you know, when we take a backward glance, that the police will infiltrate and do things to break up peace and so forth.
We have another caller from Marin. It's Eming. Are you on the line?
Yes, I am.
Hi, what's your question?
I just want to make one comment. I wanted to say that I just I saw the film that Blue Rage, Black Redemption. I have the book, and I just wanted to see if you could they could talk a little bit about the book or maybe refer it to people. And the second question is there something, some event going on, like a visual, like Monday night, the night before?
Mm-hmm.
Some place where people can go and support Stanley?
Okay. Gina, Fred?
Yes, there is. You can go to savecooks.org and you'll find information there. And I can give you 776, this is 510-776-9381, Kathleen Sullivan, who is the coordinator for our committee, and she can give you the latest update.
Mm-hmm. And we're going to have a protest outside San Quentin on Monday night, starting around, I believe, 8 o'clock. So it would be good. And the, like you said, the book was Blue Ridge, Black Redemption, and the movie is available at Blockbuster. It's just called Redemption and starring Jamie Foxx.
Unfortunately, that's all the time we have for today, our panel. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
No problem. If anything, is there any closing statements or comments you'd like to throw out, your organization or things like that?
Yes, I would like to say also, if you want Stan's book and for further information, you can call 510-235-9780. That's the Neighborhood House in North Richmond. And you can get books through and order books through the Neighborhood House in North Richmond as well as a bookstore.
Mm-hmm. And if you want to get involved in the fight against the death penalty in California or anywhere else, you can come to our meetings on the Berkeley campus or go to www.nodeathpenalty.org. And we're a grassroots activism organization trying to build public support against the death penalty.
Mr. Jackson, Ms. Spitz, my thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Well, now we leave you with Johnny Cash's hit, San Quentin. Enjoy, everyone.
San Quentin, you've been living hell to me. You blistered me since 1963. I've seen them come and go, and I've seen them die. And long ago I stopped asking why. San Quentin, I hate every inch of you. You cut me and you scarred me through and through. And I'll walk out a wiser, weaker man. Mr. Congressman, you can't understand.
And that brings us to the end of tonight's show. Tune in next week to Full Circle. Same time, Friday at 7 p.m. and same station, KPFA 94.1 FM. In the meantime, feel free to check out our archive shows at www.kpfa.org.
Special thanks to our production interns, Carmen Manguido-Niku, myself, and Jen. To our technical interns, Esther, Imogene, Antonio, and Puiman, thank you very much. And a special thanks to Idris Hassan for her feature and Dana Granby for her interview.
Our segment editor is Rangita G. Our senior producer is Veronica Moscoso. Our technical director is Ms. M. Advisors are Anita Johnson and Amelia Gonzalez. If you have any questions or topics for future shows, write us at 1929 Martin Luther King Jr. Way, Berkeley, California, 94704. If you want to purchase a taped copy of our show, our email address is fullcircle@kpfa.org. Our phone number is 510-848-6767, extension 627.
With Imogene at the controls, we've been your hosts, Jorge and Jen. Thanks for your company, everyone, here on Full Circle. Stay tuned for La Onda Bajita.
Peace out.
See ya.
We'll be right back.
yourself this holiday season and get behind the scenes of the KPFA Crafts and Music Fair at the Concourse in San Francisco, Saturday, December 10th and Sunday, December 11th. Volunteer two or more hours of your time to help us produce this annual